Hello everyone, and welcome to the CSS Security Mini Briefing, where we will present a short summary of what was released today, May 9th, 2023. My name is Josh Daniel, and I'm a risk manager in the customer service and support organization here at Microsoft. We're going to start this video with an overview of the release, and then we'll dive into a few of the vulnerabilities. Please note that the details of the vulnerabilities we're covering in this video may change, and the authoritative location for information will always be the online content in the security update guide. Now, before I dig into today's release, I like to compare it to the previous 12 months of releases to get a real feel for how this release stacks up to the previous year. And with that, today's release, we have a total of 38 newly disclosed vulnerabilities, which is roughly half of what we've been averaging in the past 13 months. Because this number of total vulnerabilities is lower, we're gonna see lower counts in some of the other metrics we'll talk to. One of the reasons for the lower total number of vulnerabilities is that this is a hot patch month. Hot patching is a technology that is applicable to a subset of Windows virtual machines running in Azure. For those machines during a hot patch month, they do not need to reboot, so that increases the uptime for those machines. For all other operating systems, reboots are typically going to be required. Next, we'll move to scoring, where Microsoft uses an industry standard scoring system called the Common Vulnerability Scoring System, or CVSS. This is a scale between 1 and 10, where 10 and the higher numbers represent more risk. On that scale of 10, this month we have two CVEs that come in at 9.8, and the average across the past 13 months is around 9.5. Next, when we look at the average score across the entire release, the average comes in at 6.56, which is quite a bit lower than our average of around 7.3. When we look at the number of remote code execution vulnerabilities, this month we have a total of 12 remote code vulnerabilities that are being addressed in today's release, which is a little bit lower than half of our average of 26 per month. There are two publicly disclosed vulnerabilities. We've been averaging right around one. We'll talk about one of those in a moment. And finally, there are two vulnerabilities known to be exploited. We've been averaging around 1.5 over the past 13 months. We'll talk about both of those vulnerabilities in just a few minutes. Now, before we get into the details of the vulnerabilities that were addressed today, let's take a look at an overview of the release. Those of you that are familiar with this slide, you'll recognize the slide where we put the Windows products towards the bottom part of the slide, and then products are not services as frequently wind up at the top of the slide. This month, with so few vulnerabilities, there are no major products that are being addressed outside of Windows and Office. In our Windows land, we average between mid-30s and mid-40s, depending on how old the operating system is. The older versions are in the mid-30s, the newer versions are in the mid-40s, and as we can see, between 15 and 20 vulnerabilities were much lower than our averages there. Again, that's due to our total count being lower than average. Now, as far as Microsoft Office-related software is concerned, we've been averaging 6 vulnerabilities addressed per month, and we are seeing exactly 6 this month, so Office is right on average there. The first vulnerability that I'll talk to from today's release is CVE-2023-24941. This is a critical remote code execution vulnerability in the network file system. This one was privately disclosed to Microsoft with no known exploits out in the wild. This is one of the vulnerabilities that has a base score of 9.8 on that scale of 10, so extremely elevated. The attack vector is over the network, the attack complexity is low. Privileges required is none, and user interaction for this vulnerability is also none. There is a mitigation here, and specifically it's that this vulnerability is only applicable to NFS version 4.1. So if you're not using that new version for whatever reason, and you're using, for example, version 2.0 or 3.0, you're not going to be affected by this. Now, if you are using NFS version 4.1, which is probably the majority of folks, then you are vulnerable to this. And to mitigate this, it's simply installing the cumulative update or on the later products, or the monthly rollup or the security only update for Server 2012 and 2012 R2. Regardless, install the update, the Windows update for this month, and you'll be protected from this vulnerability. As far as workarounds, there's no documented workarounds for this vulnerability. The affected software is all versions of Server that are in support, whether it's Server 2012 up through the latest Server 2022. The next vulnerability that I'll talk to is CVE-2023-24943. This is another critical remote code execution vulnerability, this time in the Windows Pragmatic General Multicast, or PGM, component. This one was privately disclosed to Microsoft with no known exploits out in the wild. This is the second of two vulnerabilities that has a base score of 9.8 from today's set. The attack vector is over the network. The attack complexity is low. Privileges required is none, and user interaction here is none. Now, there is a mitigation here, and specifically that it's only the PGM server that's vulnerable to this. There's other technologies such as unicast or multicast servers that are not vulnerable to this issue. Also, PGM server is something that is not on by default. It has to be installed. And so if you have not installed PGM server, you're not vulnerable to this. However, if you have installed PGM server, you have a couple different options. The first one is to install the security update that was released today. The second option is to deploy to newer technologies, again, such as unicast or multicast. There's no documented workarounds for this vulnerability. As far as affected software, it's all versions of Windows that are in support, whether it's Windows 10 and 11 on the desktop side, or Server 2012 up through Server 2022 on the server side. Next, I'll talk to CVE-2023-24932. This is an important security feature bypass vulnerability that was publicly disclosed with exploitation detected out in the wild. The base score of 6.7, we can see the attack vector is local, the attack complexity is low, privileges required is high, and user interaction here is none. So this one is quite complicated. I could spend this entire video just talking about this one CVE because of those complications. Instead, what I want you to do, if you're curious about this, is to take a look at the MSRC blog and read the KV article that's associated with this as well, KV 502 5885. There's a phased deployment here, and the May update from today, does, if you install the update alone, that does not fully protect you from this vulnerability. There's extra steps that have to be taken. I won't get into those extra steps in this video. Please see the KB article that goes with it, where those steps are written out in a very verbose way, such that I can't touch to here in this video. But essentially, it's install the update on your machines, update your images, and then go through the revocations and deploy those revocations in order to protect yourself. There, as I mentioned, there is a phased deployment for this vulnerability that's going to roll out differences in this over time. As I mentioned, there's actions that need to be taken today in order to protect yourself from this vulnerability. Over time, these protections are going to be secure by default. That secure by default phase, however, won't be until the first quarter of 2024. So there's essentially about 9 months, give or take, where this vulnerability will be in play unless you take further actions. Again, see the KB article for the exact actions that need to be taken. Now, as I mentioned, with the attack vector local, you either need to have administrative privileges to leverage this, or you need physical access to the device. Those are fairly high hurdles to meet. And so if you feel confident that no attacker is going to have physical access to your machines, and if you feel confident in your administrative privileges not being compromised, then perhaps you delay those actions and you wait until Windows is secure by default again in the first quarter of 2024. That's a risk assessment that each individual needs to take a look at. Each individual enterprise or consumer needs to look at, and is not something that we can demand, which is why Microsoft is having a phased deployment here. We want customers to assess their own risks to this, and because of the impact with outdated images, there could be a lot of work involved here, and Microsoft did not want to break many customers and their OS deployment or recovery tasks by forcing a secure by default in the May release. What this May release does is allows those customers that are concerned about their impact to deploy those protections on a manual basis. So we've laid down the infrastructure to be able to protect against this, and further mitigations and secure by default will come later in time. All right, on to the fourth vulnerability and the last one I'll cover in this video. This is CVE-2023-29336. This is an important elevation of privilege vulnerability privately disclosed to Microsoft, but exploitation was detected on this vulnerability. This has a CVSS score of 7.8 on that scale of going up to 10. So not as high as those 9.8 vulnerabilities that we were discussing, but higher than the secure boot vulnerability we just talked to. The attack vector is local, the attack complexity is low, privileges required is low, but no user interaction here is required to leverage this. There are no documented mitigations or workarounds for this vulnerability. As far as affected software, it's Windows 10, Server 2016, Server 2012, and Server 2012 R2. So it's the older versions of Windows that are affected and not the latest version. So for example, if you have Windows 11, you're not affected here. You don't have to worry about being exploited on this vulnerability. But if you're running those older operating systems that I just mentioned, there is an update for you this month, and installing that update will protect you against this vulnerability. All right, that brings us to a close. I want to thank everyone for joining me today. Let me talk to some vulnerabilities from the May 2023 release. Thank you all, and I'll talk to you all next month.